Are the UK's latest Royal Navy aircraft carriers already outdated? The Royal Navy certainly seems to think that some enhancements are required and has unveiled an ambitious plan that could result in the flight decks on both vessels being retrofitted with assisted launch systems and recovery gear. The strategic move opens the door for a diverse range of fixed-wing drone and unmanned aerial systems operations, and potentially conventional fixed-wing manned aircraft takeoffs and landings beyond those currently supported using the F-35 Lightning. However, the financial feasibility of this ambitious program remains uncertain. So, what are the limiting factors holding back the Queen Elizabeth class carriers? And what's driving the Royal Navy to consider these costly upgrades after only 3 years of service? Join me as we delve into the details of this intriguing development and explore the challenges and possibilities that lay ahead. The Queen Elizabeth class aircraft carriers of the UK's Royal Navy consists of two vessels. HMS Queen Elizabeth is the lead ship of the class and also the fleet flagship. With a length of approximately 284 metres and a displacement of 65,000 long tons, the ship was commissioned into the Royal Navy in December 2017. HMS Prince of Wales is the second carrier of the Queen Elizabeth class and was commissioned into the Royal Navy in December 2019. HMS Prince of Wales also has similar dimensions and capabilities to HMS Queen Elizabeth, making them both tied as the fifth largest active aircraft carriers in the world. At present, both carriers are equipped to support short takeoff and vertical landing using F-35B Lightning II multi-role fighters, along with Merlin and Wildcat helicopters for airborne early warning and anti-submarine warfare. In addition, depending on requirements, large troop transports such as Chinooks are used for the deployment of Royal Marines, as well as Apache attack helicopters for support and strike missions. A proposal to install catapults and arrestor gear on the carriers during their construction, and to procure the F-35C carrier variant for the air wing, was ultimately rejected due to cost considerations. Consequently, the two carriers were completed and are now fully operational in their short takeoff and vertical landing configuration, featuring a specialised 12.5 degree ski jump takeoff ramp designed to facilitate the launch operation of the F-35B aircraft. The omission of assisted launch and arresting machinery is now being recognised as a significant limitation for both vessels and their broader operational capabilities. Consequently, the Royal Navy is actively exploring options to retrofit these vessels with catapults and arresting wires. This upgrade would enable the deployment of advanced fixed-wing drones, unmanned aerial vehicles, and potentially crewed aircraft with tailhook-equipped capabilities, such as the aforementioned F-35C carrier variant. When we compare the flight deck of the Queen Elizabeth class carriers to their US counterparts, the difference in configuration becomes obvious. This is because the US carriers already employ catapults and arresting cables in their launch and recovery operations, using a system known as Catapult-Assisted Takeoff but Arrested Recovery, or CATOBAR for short. This system allows them to field a diverse range of aircraft, and, due to their flight deck configurations, US carriers can also conduct aircraft launches and recoveries simultaneously. However, on the Queen Elizabeth class carriers, simultaneous launch and recovery is still possible, but only for vertical landing aircraft, As a result, the Queen Elizabeth class currently only supports one type of fixed-wing aircraft, the F-35B. The F-35B is a versatile 5th-generation multi-role combat aircraft, capable of a wide range of missions. You can learn more about this remarkable aircraft in my dedicated video. See the link in the description and at the end of this video. Despite the F-35B's impressive capabilities, it cannot match the specialisation of aircraft design for specific roles. As a result, the United States maintains a diverse fleet of aircraft on or with their carrier groups, affording them significantly greater operational flexibility. These aircraft perform a number of roles and include the EA-18G Growler, the FA-18 Hornet and EF Super Hornet, the Grumman C-2 Greyhound, the F-35B and C Lightning II, the AV-8B Harrier II, the Grumman E-2 Hawkeye, and the CMB-22B Osprey. Out of all these aircraft, only three are short takeoff and vertical landing capable, while the rest rely on CATOBAR systems. And of course, there's an entire conversation to be had about their range of current and future carrier-based drones and unmanned aerial systems, but we'll save that one for another day. As for the Royal Navy, in May 2023 they announced Project Ark Royal, which will explore the widespread fielding of uncrewed aviation across their surface fleet, with a specific focus on future carrier aviation. The purpose of the project is to enable the operation of high-performance unmanned strike and support systems and potentially fixed-wing aircraft through the phased introduction of aircraft launch and recovery equipment on board the Queen Elizabeth class. These changes will require the installation of catapults, arrestor gear and an angled flight deck, a vision originally outlined in the 2010 Strategic Defence and Security Review. Remarkably, these carriers were built with the potential for such capabilities, but ultimately they were not equipped with them. As part of Project Ark Royal, evaluations of systems will include the electromagnetic aircraft launch system and advanced arrestor gear equipment being delivered by General Atomics for the US Navy's new Ford-class aircraft carriers, as well as the UK's own electromagnetic kinetic induction technology demonstrator. If the Royal Navy were to provide a true CATOBAR capability on their carriers, even for manned platforms, in a budget-limited world, it could in theory share some aircraft with the Royal Air Force to help spread the cost. It could even invite US and French deployments of Super Hornets and Growlers, F-35Cs and Rafael M's aboard these ships. This becomes especially valuable when the UK faces shortages of F-35Bs for deployments. The addition of CATOBAR would not only extend the reach of the carrier's air wing, but also amplify its striking power. Keep in mind that the F-35Bs, while impressive, have a notably smaller combat radius compared to their tailhook-equipped counterparts. Nevertheless, the latest Block 4 upgrades bring them closer in payload capacity to that of the F-35C. However, adopting launch and recovery systems for non-short takeoff and vertical landing operations is only one piece of a much larger puzzle. The Royal Navy must also develop control stations, establish robust data links, devise unique operational procedures, and tackle other intricacies to ensure the safe and effective integration of aircraft within the carrier air group. Another challenge lies in the absence of an angled landing area, crucial for simultaneous launch and recovery operations. Yet, there's potential here. The Queen Elizabeth class boasts ample deck width and could, in theory, be adapted to accommodate such a feature. Additionally, the existing takeoff ramps, originally designed for the short takeoff and vertical landing F-35Bs, would likely require modifications to accommodate catapult launches of drones and manned aircraft. To fully implement Project Ark Royal will be both time-consuming and expensive. Considering the rapid advancements in drones and unmanned aerial systems, a more cost-effective approach could involve equipping the carriers with a single starboard catapult dedicated exclusively to launching these types of aircraft. The priority would likely be unmanned aerial systems like the current conceptual large fixed-wing Vixen class of the Royal Navy, which would be capable of performing various missions including surveillance, air-to-air refueling, electronic warfare, and strike operations. This concept positions unmanned aerial systems as loyal wingmen, augmenting the capabilities of the carrier air wing by increasing mass, reach, and strike potential. Interestingly, the Royal Navy has already acknowledged that the Queen Elizabeth class aircraft carriers will rarely, if ever, have the option of embarking with the full complement of F-35Bs they were designed for. This realization has paved the way for an incremental strategy known as the Future Maritime Aviation Force Plan, which will see unmanned aerial systems add the mass that is needed to the air wing. While manned aircraft will undoubtedly remain the backbone of naval air power for the foreseeable future, they will increasingly be teamed with or supplemented by unmanned aerial systems. It's not a matter of if unmanned aerial systems will be preeminent in the naval air environment, but when and how quickly the Royal Navy can bring such systems into service. The future unmanned aerial systems will range in scope from light rotary wing or hand launch systems up to large platforms like the Vixen class that would still require the Queen Elizabeth class carriers to be modified with some form of aircraft launch and recovery equipment. In the short term, Project Ark Royal is expected to run until 2025 before a decision is made on the potential changes to the Queen Elizabeth class carriers. There is much to be considered, and only time will tell what types of aircraft we can expect to see departing from and returning to their flight decks in the years and decades ahead. So what do you think about the current configuration of the Queen Elizabeth class aircraft carriers? Was it a mistake to exclude CATOBAR functionality during their construction? Or do you agree with the current approach? Let me know in the comments. And if you'd like to know more about the F-35 aircraft flown from these carriers, click here. Thanks for watching. Please like, share, and subscribe to my channel for more interesting videos to come. As we bid a flight deck farewell today, remember to stay adventurous, stay curious, and keep exploring with Air, Land, Marine.